So blockchain here, you'll see a headline indicating that global spending on blockchain is going to be in the billions by next year. And what I'm gonna show you with a series of headlines is it's becoming more mainstream, right? We're seeing here large companies like Google Play are allowing their users to use their Bitcoin or equivalent cryptocurrencies. Here's an interesting one. The United Kingdom is now passing legislation or laws around another type of crypto asset called stablecoins. Again, an indication that it's becoming more widely used. Now, oftentimes, blockchain is even more powerful when we complement it with other technologies like smart contracts. Smart contracts are legal contracts that establish the terms of the contract you've entered into, and that legal contract is embedded in the blockchain. We have physical assets, things like commodities, gold, cotton, silver, real estate, tickets for an event, art, fiat currencies. Fiat currencies are the currencies of a government like the yuan or the US dollar. And you may have heard of these CBDC projects, central bank digital currency, where governments are researching how to create a digital version of their currency. And that's different from Bitcoin. Why? That's the government's treasury. It is their currency. It is backed by the government. And they're going to provide, many countries are thinking of providing a digital, because it's so much more convenient, right? It's so much more convenient. CBDCs don't have to run on blockchain, but many governments are researching using blockchain technology to facilitate the CBDCs. When we think about rights, again, we could tokenize and digitize our ownership rights in things like software, stock or ownership in a company, voting rights, etc. And then kind of in between what I think of as hybrid are these cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin and Ether, stable coins. They're sort of in the middle of those two. There's many different use cases and applications ranging from the Bitcoin cryptocurrencies to the NFTs. So we have no standards by which we can actually rely upon. And that creates uncertainty. If I'm a company or an individual and I want to start something with blockchain, I don't know how the laws are going to treat that. It's a young, nascent technology, so we're still learning how to scale it, and we have to have adoption. And this is a really challenging part. For blockchain to work, all of the stakeholders have to participate. One analogy that my colleague uses is like a telephone. If you have a mobile phone and you want to call people or text people, it only works if all of us have the phone. If I have my own phone, I'm not going to text myself. So it's the same with blockchain. I only can use it if the other stakeholders participate and adopt it as well. If you've heard that phrase, like all over the place. In China, it's fully banned, and in many other countries. In New York, where I'm from, they partially banned part of the mining process, the validation process. At least the original validation process was quite energy intensive. You may have heard some criticism about the energy usage. So New York partially banned it. They want to be environmentally friendly. Whereas another state in the United States is the opposite. They are welcoming. Wyoming is saying, come here and establish your blockchain activity because we welcome you. We are going to make this a friendly haven and create laws that incentivize and encourage this activity. In South Korea, just recently, this was like a month or two ago, the court determined that Bitcoin is considered a non-money asset, meaning it is not subject to the interest rate laws. They postponed the tax on the crypto kind of recently, or they're delaying that for a few years until more information comes out. And this one I thought was really interesting. Although it is banned in China, they had a court ruling last year that said, it's banned, but you can still trade digital currency. The regulatory landscape in China and many other countries, quite honestly, is confusing. It's just confusing. We simply, is it banned, but you can still trade it? How does that work? So it's kind of confusing when you think about that. All right, now giving you some of the kind of labels. In the US, we're a mess. Even within the government, the Internal Revenue Service, that's the tax authority in the United States, considers it property. The Securities and Exchange Commission, which is the group responsible for the capital market system for public companies, they're fighting and claiming it should be treated as a security. Right now, it's actually classified as a commodity. Korea just decided it's a non-money asset. And now you'll see it's kind of all over the place around the world. So confusing, confusing at best. Couple of companies, public companies in the US that have among the largest holding of Bitcoin are Tesla and MicroStrategy. When Tesla first started to purchase and hold Bitcoin, you'll see here it was really lucrative. They were making more money on Bitcoin than on their real operations of selling cars. So there was this volatility in the valuation of the Bitcoin, and the accounting rules made it very confusing and controversial. For the past couple of years, there's been a lot of controversy around, not even controversy, criticism about the treatment, the accounting treatment for this for these holdings. So how should the holdings of cryptocurrency be classified under both the US accounting rules and the international financial reporting standards? So the choices that were available, all of us can agree something like Bitcoin is what we consider an asset. An asset is an economic resource or a benefit. So these were the choices. Cash, it didn't meet the definition of cash. Cash, by definition, under both of the accounting rules, is really considered something that's backed by a government and that is widely used in the process of doing business. Well, Bitcoin and other types of cryptocurrency didn't meet that definition. Next, we had inventory. Does anybody know what inventory is in accounting? It's very narrowly defined as the product you sell your customers. So if I'm Tesla, it's my cars and batteries. If I'm Apple, it's the iPhones and the iPads. Under US accounting rules, it's even more narrow, where inventory has to be tangible, physical, right? You have to have a substance. So if you're a company that's selling Bitcoin, limited circumstances, you could classify it. The last one of number four, other type of investment, didn't work. That's about insurance contracts. None of them worked. All right, we have one more. Intangible assets. Those assets that don't have a physical substance. Okay, so that's what all of these companies are using because that's the only choice that's left. So, what does that mean? Lacks a physical substance, so it is considered an intangible asset. Furthermore, other things like intangible assets, by the way, are things like a patent. You know, if you have a patent where you get exclusive rights to a vaccine formula or a recipe or a pharmaceutical drug, well, it's limited in its life, a patent. You have it for 20 years. A copyright for published written work. Bitcoin doesn't have a legal life, right? It's indefinite. And the accounting treatment is specific for those assets. So it's considered an indefinite lived intangible asset. What does that mean? All right, when a company like Tesla purchases Bitcoin, they record it on their books at what they paid, okay? Easy peasy. Under IFRS standards, and under our accounting rules, by the way, we don't let companies just record things at what they paid and just leave it like that, right? If something loses value or changes in value, they have to acknowledge that and report that. Because we don't want companies having like old, you know, junky stuff on their balance sheet saying, look how great, we have all these assets, when really it's like a piece of junk. We make them acknowledge if there has been a change. Because with Bitcoin, it's not one market. It's not like there's one market like the stock market, you know, on the Korean exchange or the US exchange. There's hundreds and hundreds of markets. So first of all, with things like crypto, I want to remind everybody, it's unregulated. So when you have, you may have heard of this phrase of the crypto winter, which represented a radical decline in the value of cryptocurrencies. It's unregulated. There is no regulation. There is no government backing. There is no insurance if things go wrong. You may have heard also of the FTX exchange fraud that happened a few months back. How many of you heard of the FTX fraud? It was a huge, which was really had nothing to do with crypto, by the way. It really was just a good old fashioned fraud. It seems like it's still under investigation, but with things like Bitcoin and crypto, when there is no structure or rules, and there's no government that can come in to try to control the supply and demand, that's kind of at your own risk. And that's one of the benefits, right? Everybody was like, we don't want the government involved. We want peer-to-peer. And that's great until things go wrong and then people want the security. So in terms of predicting the value, Bitcoin itself is limited in the number of Bitcoin that will ever be produced. There will only be a certain number and then it will be out. Other types of cryptocurrency that have been created since, and there are thousands of different ones, by the way, thousands. All of their protocol or their structure vary. So I wish I could tell you, because if I would be very, very rich.